Thanks for joining us for Ruth Institute's podcast. Our website is www.ruthinstitute.org. We seek to promote and strengthen traditional marriage. I encourage you to sign up for our free e-newsletter at the website, which has information on what we're doing around the country and how you can be involved. Welcome to ITAF. It Takes a Family to Raise a Village is Ruth Institute's annual student conference. Dr. J delivers the closing lecture, It Takes a Family to Raise a Village. She takes questions afterward, too, so stay tuned for one more ITAF podcast.
Before I start this last talk, let me just say it's been a pleasure. This has been a really fun group, okay? And I expect good things from you guys. I mean, I'm looking forward to you guys doing stuff. You know, because we picked you because you're already doing stuff and because you're already motivated. And hopefully we've equipped you and inspired you a little bit more, you know, so that you can continue to be involved in your various spheres of influence. So we're really excited about ITAF 2013. And I hope that you will be part of the Emerging Leaders Group and all that stuff so that you can continue to be part of it. So, the last talk. Now, ITAF has been going on for 5 years, as you know, and the talks have kind of morphed a little bit. At the beginning of when I first started doing the It Takes a Family program, we didn't really talk about gay marriage per se that much. But now it's really necessary to talk about the issue of the definition of marriage. And so I'm going to close this. I always like to open and close the program, and I'm going to close with a talk that is, when I do it, is a kind of a generic talk on defending marriage. So if you were to invite me to your school or to your church or your women's group or whatever, this is more or less the defending marriage talk. This is more or less what it would look like. But I'm going to add into it these sort of basic slides that I have. I'll be adding into it things that try, hopefully, to draw together themes that we've already been talking about during the past couple of days here at the It Takes a Family to Raise a Village conference, because you've had some enormous intellectual firepower here. I think you'll agree. You've had some pretty cool people. And so you've been able to talk about some things in depth. And so some things that I would might have to explain to an audience of your peers, for instance, back at your school, I'm not going to have to explain as much because Bill Duncan already covered it or whatever. Okay, so there'll be some of that. And then there'll be some of, I get to look over my shoulder and draw out some of the things that, for example, Dr. Yenner had to say. Okay, so this talk will not only be kind of a generic defending marriage talk, but it'll be one that will hopefully tie together all the different themes that we've been talking about for the last few days. So, this is a little bit of Catholic triumphalism that I sometimes like to put on my first slide. It says, the Catholic Church oppressing our oppressive government since 33 AD. So I like to start with that slide. And I hope those of you who are not Roman Catholics don't take offense at it, but obviously the point of this is that, you know, we've kind of seen it all, right? Yesterday, I gave my little pep talk about the attacks on the human body that have been part of the sexual revolution, and I don't know if you remember this or caught this, but the first word out of Gagnon's mouth when he talked after that is he said the word Gnosticism. Did any of you catch that he said Gnosticism? Okay, and what is Gnosticism? It's the oldest and most persistent enemy of Christianity, right? It's the oldest Christian heresy, which basically has a kind of mind-body dualism, a separation of the mind from the body, and a kind of resentment of the human body, that the body has limitations and the true spiritual person can somehow overcome and transcend all of the limitations of the human body. So this is a very deep battle that we're fighting, in a sense, to be dealing with Gnosticism. And of course, the other thing about Gnosticism, Gnostics believe that you can save yourself, that with your secret knowledge, you can save yourselves. That has always been part of the Gnostic heresy, hasn't it? And if there's anything we ought to know at the end of the 20th century, it's that we can't save ourselves. Right? I mean, shouldn't we have that figured out after all the different things that we tried during the 20th century and the rivers of blood that we created? We really should have that one down. But we don't. So here we go again. With another version, in a sense, of a similar kind of heresy. So As Jesus says, take heart, I have overcome the world. Or as he said in Mark in the gospel reading of a few days ago, the blind man was there calling out, Jesus, son of David, have pity on me. People are telling him to shut up. Jesus says, bring him to me. And then people say to the blind man, what do they say to them? They say, take heart, get up. Jesus is calling you. Hey, guys, it doesn't get any better than that. Let's go, that's what I want to say. Let's go if Jesus is calling, we're there. All right, so a lot of times people will ask me, Dr. Morris, you're talking to young people all the time. They say young people are all in favor of gay marriage. What's going on with the young people? Is this true? Is it true? Do they really all believe in gay? Are they really on the tank for all of this crazy stuff that's going on? And here's what I tell adult audiences. This is the kind of thing that I try to emphasize. Look, in order to believe that there is such a thing as gay marriage, in order to believe that there is such a thing as a union of two persons who are of the same sex, in order to believe that that's the same thing as marriage, there are a bunch of things you have to already believe. Okay, you have to have already bought into a couple of things. And there are at least three that I can think of that are significant. First, you have to believe that men and women are interchangeable. In order to buy the idea that gay marriage or same-sex unions are plausibly the same thing as an opposite-sex union, you have to believe that men and women are interchangeable in every important respect. Okay? That's the first thing you have to believe. Second, you have to believe that marriage is principally about adults and their feelings and only incidentally about children and their needs. That marriage is principally about adults and how they feel, and only incidentally or secondarily about children and what they actually need. And the third thing you have to believe to find the idea of same-sex unions plausible is you have to believe that sex is basically and normatively a sterile activity. That sex is normatively sterile, that you can act on the assumption that sex is a sterile activity, and that reproduction is kind of thrown in as an afterthought if you happen to have quirky lifestyle preferences, if you want to accessorize your relationship, right? You can, if you want to, you can have a baby. But basically, the idea is that sex is a sterile activity. Now, let me ask you this. Do you recognize these three beliefs as prominent, common beliefs within our culture? Do you recognize this? Isn't this, in fact, what a lot of people think? Yeah, a lot of people think if you say men and women are different, you better be ready to take some shots, right? It's like we flinch from saying the opposite of any of these things, don't we? It's like booby trap, to say the opposite of any of these things. So if you believe these three things, and a lot of people do, a lot of people in our culture have consumed and taken in these three ideas, well, why not let two guys get married? Why not let two women get married? Why not redefine marriage? Well, because you've already said the gender of the body is irrelevant. You've already said that marriage is irrelevant. You've already said that sex itself is irrelevant, socially irrelevant. So why not redefine marriage, right? So you've already given away the barn. Now, paradigm of saying this to people, that this is what people have to accept and that many people have accepted, this I find to be very powerful with audiences who are listening to me for the first time, because it registers that these things, when you state them this starkly, these things aren't true, and yet these are the things that we believe. Okay, and I'll add parenthetically to all of you who are hopefully going to get married one day or trying to maintain a happy marriage, that if you believe these three things, your chances of having a happy marriage are about zero, okay? If you enter into married life thinking that your husband or your wife is just like you, you're gonna have a problem. You're gonna have a real problem. If you enter into it thinking that it's about you and how you feel, you're gonna wanna run from it the first time the feelings aren't good, right? And if you think that sex is simply a sterile activity, of course you've completely misunderstood the depth and the beauty and the significance of human sexuality. So these things, not only are they false, not only are they leading us to do things that are politically and socially half crazy, but they're also going to sabotage your attempt to have the one thing that everybody does want, which is reliable love right? A happy, lifelong married life. These things are actively in the way. So in this way, the question over whether we should have gay marriage or not is a question that is at the end, or I shouldn't say the end, probably in the middle, of a whole train of things that we call the sexual revolution. So we like to situate the marriage question within the larger picture of the sexual revolution. Of course, we've been doing that this weekend all along, and that's why it's taken us more than 20 minutes to talk about this subject, right? Okay, so I like to start with a little thought experiment. I've got an image here of a baby with two people who are apparently the baby's parents, okay? The mother and the father and the baby. And I'd just like to ask you to do a little thought experiment. You can tell they're related to each other because of the matching sunglasses. I don't know how that works genetically, but you know, there you go. Designer baby, maybe that's what it is. Anyway, let's start with a thought experiment. Start our discussion with a thought experiment. What does society owe to these three people? Does society owe them anything? We know some people would say we owe them free medical care or free daycare or housing, all kinds of stuff like that. That would be plausibly on some people's list of things that you owe this little family. But I say there's something more basic, something much more basic that we owe these three people. We owe it to all three of them to affirm that these two people are the parents of this child and no one else is. No one else. There are no other competing claimants for the title of parent and parental rights. Not your previous boyfriend, not grandma. Okay, those of you from very traditional families, when I did this at the Filipino Couples for Christ meeting, they were kind of tittering when I said grandma's not, because legally grandma's, socially grandma's very involved, but legally grandma's not involved, right? And your next door neighbor who has a doctorate in child development, she's not involved, right? She can't come swooping in and say, I'm better, right? No, these two people are the parents of this child and no one else is. Now, what I want you to see about that immediately is that is intrinsically a public social purpose. That is intrinsically a social and public function. In other words, just because these two people have a little contract and say, hey, we're the parents of this baby, and we get to be the parents of the baby, we've made our little agreement amongst ourselves, and so therefore, it's all privatized. You ever heard this idea that we should privatize marriage? Okay, so these two people have this little plan, and that's going to be their plan. What's going to happen if somebody disagrees? Somebody's going to have to push away the competing claimants, right? Somebody's going to have to tell grandma to go away. Somebody's going to have to tell the previous boyfriend to go pound sand, and so on, right? And that is a public function. They can't do that themselves. They need the courts. They need the police. They need help to do that. That is what society owes to these three people, is to say that these two people are the parents of this child and nobody else is. And that brings us to what I consider to be the most important point about the whole debate, is what is the essential public purpose of marriage? What is the essential public purpose of marriage? Now, you might think we've been talking about this for 4 days. Why did it take us this long to get here? Now I think you can see we've kind of built up to this question of what's the essential public purpose of marriage. I say that the essential public purpose of marriage is to attach mothers and fathers to their children and to one another. That's the essential public purpose of marriage, to attach mothers and fathers to their children and to one another. Now that is a public purpose, that is an essential public purpose in the precise legal sense. In legal terms, something's essential in a but-for sense, okay? But for this purpose, but for the purpose of attaching children to their parents, you would not need marriage in the first place. Right, so it's essential in that kind of definitional way. Do you see what I mean? If it weren't for needing to accomplish this purpose, no one would have ever thought of lifelong sexual monogamy. You know, it just wouldn't have entered anybody's mind that this is what we need to do. That nobody would place that constraint on themselves. Nobody would have thought of the tax breaks and the health care and all this stuff. Nobody would have thought of it if it weren't for needing to get this particular job done. This is the essential core public purpose of marriage. Now, And you can think about it. If we were different kinds of creatures, you wouldn't need to get this done, right? So if we reproduce through sexual reproduction, production. I'm sorry to be explicit, but you know, it takes a man and a woman. We've talked about this weekend, and most of you already knew, I think, that it took a man and a woman to get this done. Okay. Anyway, if that were not true of us biologically, we wouldn't need to do this. If we were the type of creatures that were born, grown up, and ready to just take care of ourselves, like reptiles are, right? You wouldn't need it, right? So there's a mother snake and a father snake, but there's no pair bonding, as far as I know, in the reptile kingdom. Babies slither away as soon as they hatch, right? It's all done. So that's the sense in which it's an essential purpose. Now, what do I mean when I say public? It's a public purpose in the sense that it's different from all of the private reasons that people might have for wanting to get married. Okay, in other words, people, and normally when we have this debate and you hear people talk about wanting to get married, what you will hear are the private reasons. You'll hear what they personally want, okay? And there are many possible private reasons for wanting to get married, right? So you might want to get married because you want the health benefits, because you want to feel good about yourself. You might want to do it to get your parents off your back. When are you going to marry the girl? You know, that kind of stuff. You might want to do it because you want the pretty dress. You might want to irritate your previous boyfriend. There could be all kinds of reasons why you privately, personally want to get married. But you take all those together, and it doesn't add up to a public reason to have the institution of marriage in the first place. You see what I mean? There's no reason the state would ever get involved in your wardrobe choices for one day. You know, I'm just saying, it's none of their business. Right? So that's the sense in which it is a public purpose, not a private purpose. So this is the essential public purpose of marriage. Now, there are a couple things to be said about this public purpose. Let me see what I say next. Okay. The first thing to say is that when you see this, when you think about this, you can see immediately that a same-sex couple is situated differently with respect to this purpose than an opposite-sex couple. Right, can you immediately see that? Do I have to spell that out? Okay, and Bill Duncan's second talk really dealt with the fact that a same-sex couple is situated differently with respect to an opposite-sex couple. All of the kind of crazy cases he was coming up with, all the crazy things the courts are doing and so on, are generated by the fact that the same-sex couple is not the same with respect to this particular purpose. Now, under the law of discrimination, if things are situated differently, it's okay to treat them differently. It's not discrimination to treat something different if it is different. That's not discrimination. It's perfectly okay. And so therefore, when the courts go to redefine marriage, they have to redefine the purpose of marriage. Many courts, you may not know this, but many courts, in fact, numerically speaking, most courts that have considered this question have said, no problem with man-woman marriage. There's no discrimination there. There's an essential purpose, a procreative purpose is perfectly fine. Fine, no problem. But in the few cases where the courts have redefined marriage, what they have had to do is to redefine the purpose of marriage. They've had to rewrite that purpose of marriage. They've had to write out that public purpose, that essential public purpose, and not only downgrade it. You'll sometimes in debate, you'll hear people downgrade it. They'll say, procreation is important, but love is important too. Procreation is not the only thing that's important. But you know what? Legally, that wouldn't be good enough. Legally, what you need to do is take it off the list. You got to take it off, because if it's on the list, they're still different, right? So it's got to go off the list of essential public purposes. So now I'm going to read to you the quotation that Bill Duncan read to you a couple of days ago. This is Judge Vaughn Walker, who overturned Proposition 8. Here's what he said the purpose of marriage was. And you can see as he's doing this that he knows that what he's got to do. He knows that he's got to somehow redefine the essential purpose of marriage. Here's what he says. Marriage is the state recognition and approval of a couple's choice to live with each other. Hold it right there. Why do I need approval? Why would we care about that? Where are the libertarians when we need them? Right? Why are we looking for anybody's approval for the state's approval for our choice to live with each other? Anyway, to live with each other, to remain committed to one another, and to form a household based on their own feelings about one another, and to join in an economic partnership and support one another and any dependence, close quote. You see that this definition has nothing to do with children, and it has nothing to do even with sex. You don't have to be in a sexual union in order to invoke this definition of the purpose of marriage. So, you guys who are rooming together this weekend, I hope you didn't share a lot of money over the course of the weekend, or you can count as married under this definition. Okay? I'm just saying. Okay? So they've wiped out the essential purpose of marriage and replaced it with, let us face it, a bunch of private purposes. It replaced it with things that are not essential and that are private. So let's talk for a minute about how marriage accomplishes this purpose. Bill Duncan, again, referred to this, so let me spell it out for you again. The presumption of paternity helps us to establish who the parents are. When the baby is born, there's always a mother somewhere close by. We always know who the mom is, except for surrogate mothers. We have to put a little asterisk up there, right? That if you're a paid surrogate, you give birth to the baby, you're not necessarily the mother, okay? But aside from that, up until the day before yesterday, everyone knew who the mother was as soon as the baby was born. The social problem is to find out who the father is and to attach the father. And so the way marriage answers that question is the marriage says the wife's husband is the father of the child. The wife's husband is presumed to be the father of any children that she gives birth to during the life of their union. That's what the presumption of paternity does. And so you can see that that supports what is intrinsically a public purpose of marriage by defining who the legal parents are, and something that you can't entirely privatize. Okay? What Von Walker has given us, what this definition has given us, is basically a government registry of friendships. That's basically what he's given us. And then you have to ask yourself, well, what the heck do we need a government registry of friendships for? And the answer is nothing. We don't need a government registry of friendships. Next move, abolish marriage. Because we've stripped everything out of marriage that gives it an essential public purpose. We've taken that all away. Replaced it with private purposes, for which now the state's involvement is completely intrusive, right? And so, therefore, the next step will be the complete abolition of marriage. So that's how marriage accomplishes this purpose. Now, you may have noticed that I avoid using the term same-sex marriage. I want to say just a couple of words about that. Why do I avoid the use of that term? Because my position is that there's no such thing as a same-sex marriage. My position is there's no such thing as a same-sex marriage. And every time we use that term, we make our opponent's view sound plausible. We make their position sound like a plausible, believable thing. So, you know, you can imagine a pink unicorn. That doesn't mean they exist, right? If we keep talking about them, we're going to start thinking they exist. So there's no point in us carrying water for these guys because they get plenty of airtime, as Autumn told us in her last talk. So instead, what I will use are different kinds of phrases to accomplish the same thing. I think that it's not a virtue to have a short phrase to define somebody else's position. That's an advantage for them. We don't need to help them, okay? So a big, long, clunky, uncomfortable phrase for their position is perfectly okay, especially if it's descriptive, right? If it's accurately descriptive. So sometimes I will say, we're talking about redefining marriage to be the union of any two persons instead of the union of a man and a woman. Now, doesn't that just roll off your tongue? Right? But that's what we're doing. Legally speaking, that's exactly what we're doing. Every place it says in the statute book, man or woman, we're going to take that out. We're going to put any two persons. That's what we're doing, okay? I once debated a gay man who didn't realize that that's what we were doing. He got all offended when I said, you're in favor of marriage being the union of any two persons. Oh, no, that could include... No. All the other prohibitions are separate, you know, but this is what you're doing. The other thing you can say is we're talking about removing the gender requirement for marriage. That's a very important phrase to think about. You're removing the gender requirement for marriage. Or you're making marriage into a genderless institution or a gender-neutral institution. That's a very important thought to plant into people's mind because it's accurate. It's accurate. Autumn didn't mention this in her talk, but one of the things that went on in Minnesota as they were... Oh, I think Bill mentioned it, actually. Yeah, Bill mentioned it in his talk, that... In Minnesota, they're requiring that the terms mother and father be interpreted in a gender-neutral way. Now, what the heck does that mean, to interpret mother and father as a gender-neutral thing? Okay, so they're making the whole institution gender-neutral. This is a very important alternative expression to use instead of same-sex marriage or same-sex union. Or you can say they're trying to make the same-sex union the legal equivalent of marriage. That also drives your thought. And the good thing about this is it drives your thought patterns down somewhat different channels each time, right? It reminds you of something different. But that's important, because what people are doing on the other side is to focus everything down onto one topic, namely equality, and all of these other very important issues are being shoved aside. So that's why I try to use the term, I try not to use the term same-sex marriage, and I would encourage you to think about that. So I now want to talk about how redefining marriage will undermine some key social and legal principles. The first principle, and some of these we've kind of already talked about over the course of this weekend, but we'll just review them and put them all in one place here. The first one is that kids are entitled to a relationship with both of their parents, with their mothers and their fathers. Children are entitled, ordinarily entitled to that, and that it's an important entitlement. I know somebody said they're freaked out over the words rights and entitlements and stuff, and I'm not a lawyer, so I don't get freaked out easily over that. So I get to say that. And so the negative consequence that will flow from doing that is that marriage will become the thing that separates children from their parents, rather than the thing that attaches children to their parents. Yeah, marriage will become the very thing that separates children from their parents. So if you're looking at something like the Miller-Jenkins case, the fact that they had a civil union is the thing that said that these two people are considered legal parents of the child, and any involvement by the father would be out of bounds. Now, in one of the previous conversations, I think when Alana was talking about this, the separation of the father through anonymous sperm donation is interesting to think about in this regard, because what anonymous sperm donation is doing is saying that the state is taking the role of separating a child from his parents, that the state is taking the responsibility and the job of pushing the father out of the child's life. That's part of what's involved with that. So marriage, by changing the presumption of paternity to a presumption of parentage, a gender-neutral presumption of parentage, you're separating the child from one of its parents. Second point, we now kind of think, some of us sort of think, that mothers and fathers are not interchangeable. Right? Mothers and fathers are not interchangeable. The kids have a mom and a dad. They need a mom and a dad. But the principle that a same-sex union is the equivalent of an opposite-sex union means that you have to be asserting that they are interchangeable. And the net result of that will not fall equally on men and women. Okay, we're all about trying to be equal, right? But this kind of superficial equality is not going to impact the genders equally. I believe that this idea will have the negative consequence of further marginalizing fathers from the family, of marginalizing men from the family. In other words, if you say moms and dads are interchangeable, that's not going to have the same impact on the mothers as it has on the fathers. Mothers are naturally attached to their children just because of the birth canal and the umbilical cord and the whole thing. Attaching a father is the more difficult social and emotional job. And so if you say they're equivalent, the person who's most likely to be shunted aside is going to be the father. As an example of this, or as a bit of evidence for this, because obviously this is not a kind of syllogistic claim that you could make in a logical progression of A to B to C, and it's obviously necessarily going to happen. It's kind of more impressionistic thing. Mark Rickneris would be freaked out to hear me say this, right, because there's no actual data. But to support the idea that this is a plausible thing that could be happening, I present to you a birth certificate from British Columbia. As you guys know, Canada redefined marriage, and each province had to do something about the birth certificate. So this is another thing that, you know, in the aftermath of redefining marriage, something's got to be done about the birth certificates. So what they do, this is kind of small here, you can't see it so easily. At the top here, you've got the mother's information. You know, you write down who's the mom, you know, her name or date of birth, blah, blah, blah. And then down here, it says father or co-parents information. And there's a checkoff box that you can check off. It says, I am the father of the child, or I am not the father of this child, but have agreed to be registered as the co-parent of the child. So on this birth certificate, motherhood is still legally and socially intact, but fatherhood has been reduced to a checkoff box. Okay? So I don't think that is all that surprising in a sense, if you think about the trajectory of this whole thing. Okay. Next principle is that biology, the third principle is that biology is the primary way we define parenthood. And again, Bill Duncan talked a bit about this, you know, that basically biology, parenthood is a natural biological reality that the state simply records. The state doesn't invent it or create it. The state simply records the reality that's already out there. If you ask a small child who's the mommy and who's the daddy, you know, they can immediately pick out which horse he is the mommy and which horse he's the daddy. All cultures, all places and times, you know, any place more advanced than the most primitive tribe knows that there's a mother and a father and that the two of them come together and create the baby, right? I mean, you have to go back really far for people to not get that. Like they're standing in the river and the river god's fertilizing you or something. I mean, that's really quite primitive to deny this, okay? So what's the consequence of removing biology as the basis for parenthood? Well, I want to tell you about a case that we haven't talked about so far, which is a case of a little girl called MC. And this is a California case. And this case was actually came to my attention as it was happening in 2011 because I had an ITAF student and Blackstone fellow. I know we have a couple Blackstone people here. We had a Blackstone fellow for the summer who we gave him the job of researching all of the lesbian custody cases that he could find on LexisNexis. You know, he just went and looked for all the disputed custody cases where two women were fighting over custody of a child. And one that came up right at that time was this case called In Re Parentage of MC. And MC was born in March of 2009. The dates are significant. The dates are very significant. Her mother conceived her by being in a relationship with a man, okay? Her mother's name, I'm going to give them names because there's so many characters in the story, you will forget who's who. The child's mother, MC's mother, is named Melissa. And she conceived MC by being with a guy called Jesus, so a heterosexual relationship with a known father. Not a sperm donor, a father, right? I mean, the old-fashioned way this was done, okay? Well, Melissa, while she was pregnant, married a woman called Irene in October of 2008, right there in that window of time before Prop 8 passed. Okay, October of 2008, she married Irene. They had kind of a stormy, rocky relationship, but they were legally married under the laws of California at that time. MC was born in March of 2009. There are three of them are living together, Irene, Melissa, and MC. And Melissa decides she doesn't want to be there anymore. She doesn't want to live with this woman anymore. For whatever reason, we don't really know why. You can speculate, but we don't really know why. But so she leaves and she takes the baby with her. And then what happens is that Irene gets very upset, very irate, and wants to have custody of the baby that she's lived with for 3 weeks, that she has no biological relationship to, that she has not adopted, and it's quite clear that Melissa would not consent to an adoption, right? Quite, she's leaving, right? So you live with this child for 3 weeks, but she goes to court to try to get custody. So Melissa does the sort of obvious thing. She gets a new boyfriend, and she and the new boyfriend stalk Irene and beat her up so badly, she goes to the hospital, and Melissa goes to prison. Sorry, Melissa and her boyfriend, they go to prison. So MC goes into foster care, right? Protective Services shows up, there's this baby, they take the little girl into protective custody. Well, around about that time, Jesus reappears. And Jesus says, I'm the father of this child. I would like to get the child out of foster care and take care of the child, because this is my child. Well, the courts look at this situation and they say, well, no, wait a second. We don't know about you, Jesus, but we do know under a gender-neutral reading of the Uniform Parentage Act, Irene is presumed to be the child's other parent. And under California law, a child cannot have three parents. So buzz off, Jesus. Because to give her to you, to give the little girl to you, would interfere with her interest in reunification with Irene. So you can see that gay marriage, so-called, okay, genderless marriage, became the vehicle that separated this little girl from her biological father. And as it turns out, she finally is with her father. It took 2.5 years for that to happen. Okay, she was in foster care for 2.5 years while the courts figured this out. And naturally, naturally, California being California, the natural solution to this problem that the gay lobby came up with, the obvious solution to this problem is to allow children to have three parents. And so that's a statute that was passed in response to this bill last summer, and thankfully Jerry Brown vetoed it. But it sailed through both houses of the legislature, three parents. So the necessary consequence of unlinking biology and parenthood from each other is that triple parenting is going to be unstoppable. Triple parenthood will simply be unstoppable. Some of the cases it will happen because by people's consent because they want it, because they've got a friend that they like and they want to put the person on the birth certificate. It's going to be all lovey-dovey and wonderful and nice. But they've got to manage that relationship for a lifetime. Right? And so what ends up happening is the courts end up getting involved to manage and deal with and cope with relationships which are really not stable enough to be marriages in the first instance. There's another case. I don't know if I have it up here. No, I don't have it up here. There's another case. There was a British case where it was two women and two men, you know, forming a relationship to have children. And that, of course, broke down. And so they were in court with a 7-year-old child who was seriously emotionally disturbed, and then a 5-year-old child trying to figure out who's going to get the custody of these kids, because the women didn't want the men to have anything to do with it anymore. Okay? And you could read in the text of the thing, the judge is like banging his head against the wall, trying to figure what to do. What is he going to do with these people, with these adults? And he scolds the adults from the bench, but eventually he did give the kids to the two women and say the guys get to come every 2 weeks or something like that, you know. He basically gave the women what they wanted. But you could see him, you know, it's like his wig was exploding off of his head, you know. It just wasn't computing. So what I think we need to say about that is that that situation created a situation where there is no just outcome. See, there's no just solution to this dilemma that they've created, okay? And if you have something where you are structurally creating injustices, what is the proper thing to do about that? Stop creating those structures, right? Prohibit it. Prohibit this thing which has structural injustice built into it. And that's what I want to say, that we're talking about structural injustices to children here, which is different from whether people have good parenting skills or not. The final principle that I want to draw out is that we currently believe that the state recognizes parentage as a natural institution, but it doesn't assign it, it doesn't control it. And that, of course, is exactly what's going by the wayside. The state is taking ownership of the whole definition of parenthood. In other words, redefining marriage redefines parenthood. And the state is taking ownership of something that used to be a completely natural reality. Now, again, where are the libertarians when we need them? How can this be a government-minimizing move when the state is taking for itself a whole realm of civil society, of social reality that used to be considered purely natural? And so I believe the negative consequence of that is that the expansion of state power will be simply breathtaking in its scope. And everything we've talked about with respect to religious liberty is an example of that. But in addition to that, the state is involved in defining who counts as a parent by micromanaging the household, by saying, did you wipe enough noses and change enough diapers for you to count as a de facto parent? That's what's going on to make these kind of judicial determinations about who counts as a parent. And I've got something up here called the Quebec Policy Against Homophobia, which is something that should make your hair curl. This is something that the Quebec did 2009, I think it was. In here, they want to wipe out all homophobia and heteronormativity, heterosexism. Do you guys know what heteronormativity is? Some of you might know. Heteronormativity means the belief that homosexuality is normal. Guys, heterosexuality is normal in our species, right? Okay, so the government of Quebec is committing itself to wiping out a belief in something that's true. It's going to take a lot of state power to get that done. It's going to take a lot of state power to do that, and that's what they're committing themselves to. So, what is owed to the child? I say that society owes to the child a family. Society owes to the child an identity, some knowledge of who they are. And the people who don't agree with that are now going to great lengths to try to justify their position. There's a law professor at Harvard who is arguing that the children don't have any preconception rights. that as long as you let the child be born, they're supposed to be grateful for that. And so even though you can forecast all the kinds of things that we've heard about, that's no reason to prohibit it. Because after all, their life is better than a life of unremitted pain. And so until you get to this threshold of complete worthlessness of your life, you're not doing anything to be prohibited. So all we owe to children under this view is mere survival. Mere survival. These little children, this is an image that I found by Googling Romanian orphan children, okay? And this is what comes up. It's okay to do this, right? It's okay to structurally plan to do this because, after all, we let them be born, and it's not a life of unremitting, terrible pain. So I say that children have legitimate entitlements. They are entitled to relationship with two parents. They are entitled to know who they are. Therefore, children have an interest in the stability of their parents' union. That's why children have an interest, a legitimate interest in the stability of their parents' union. And these are rights and entitlements that have to be defended proactively. You can't wait until a six-year-old has their parents completely fall apart and expect the six-year-old to march into court and get damages. You know, it just doesn't work that way. So we protect children's rights institutionally and proactively through the institution called marriage. That's what marriage is all about. It's there for the protection of children. And now I want to close with just stoking your emotions a little bit, because we've talked about stoking emotions, and we're going to just do a little experiment here. This is an image. I don't know how well you can see it. This is a Nazi-era image of a group of Catholic priests giving the Hitler salute. Now, how does this make you feel to see these priests giving this Hitler salute? As a Catholic, it makes me creeped out completely. It's totally embarrassing, and it's awful. And they look like idiots or worse. Now, for the Lutherans are doing it too. Does this make us feel better? To see the Lutheran pastors all lined up here, see they are in their little caps and their little scarves and the whole thing. And here's this flag that has a cross in it and a swastika in the middle of the cross and DC, Deutsche Kirche, the German church. The Nazified German church. Okay, does this make you feel better? Catholics, do you feel better knowing that the Lutherans are doing it too? No, doesn't do anything for me. They look stupid too. That's all that does for me. Right? They all look like idiots doing this. Well, on the other hand, there's this guy, Dietrich Bonhoeffer. He saw what was coming. You all know who Dietrich Bonhoeffer was? Okay, he was the guy who was the Lutheran pastor who stood up to the Nazis and who was executed by them with 2 weeks left in the war. He saw what was coming. He saw that it was wrong. How about this guy, Maximilian Kolbe, Polish priest, Polish Catholic priest? He saw that it was no good. He saw that what Nazism meant. And what is it that they saw? What is it that they realized? They didn't know about the death camps because death camps hadn't happened yet. Right, they didn't know about that. What did they know? They could see from the very beginning that Nazism was a pagan ideology that no Christian should have anything to do with. That's what they could see from the beginning. Right, from 1933, they could see this is a pagan ideology that no Christian should have anything to do with. So let's think about our own legacy. Think about the sexual revolution. People didn't know every single thing that was going to flow from the different steps and the different phases of the sexual revolution, right? People couldn't predict all of that. But what we did know and should have known and can still know is that it's a pagan ideology that no Christian should have anything to do with, right? That's what we can know. And so we have to ask ourselves, as Christians engaged in a great battle for the soul of our country and indeed for the soul of the world, what is our legacy going to be? We're going to be Maximilian Kolbe and Dietrich Bonhoeffer, or are we going to look like these knuckleheads? Because mark my words, this thing cannot last. The sexual revolution is so irrational, it will eventually implode. And 100 years from now, people are going to look back on us and they're going to say, what were those people even thinking? What were they thinking? So that's why I think we are on the right side of history, and I'm very proud to be here with you today. Because I do not accept these things as normal. I said this to you the first night. I'm going to say it to you again. You heard Alana's story. I refuse to accept that as normal. I don't care how commonly it happens. It's wrong. And I hope you feel the same way too. Thanks very much.
just been listening to Dr. J's closing lecture, It Takes a Family to Raise a Village, at Ruth Institute's student conference this year. Our website is www.ruthinstitute.org, and we're also on Facebook. Like the Ruth Institute or Dr. Jennifer Robeck Morse pages for updates. Our podcasts can be found online at ruthinstitute.libsyn.com and iTunes, and as always, they're under a Creative Commons license. If you've enjoyed them, please share them with friends. The Ruth Institute is a nonprofit educational organization devoted to bringing hope and encouragement for lifelong married love.